Shalom and welcome to another weekly Bible study as we continually rightly divide the word of Yahweh as a workman. Now in our last few videos we had gone into the study on Revelation 11:1 and the two witnesses. There is a study I wanted to put up. We'll take just a little break from the two witnesses because when we go back in on our next study, there's so much in those verses, and you know, I get a little bit long-winded teaching them, so I don't want it to become that you get uninterested, because it's very, very important. So thought we might take a little break from that, and I've been meaning to put this study up for months and months and months, so I decided to do it tonight, and we're going to be looking in Psalms and in a verse that uses the word Kairos, which we've talked about a lot, which is actually synonymous with Moed. Now, the reason it's so important through the Old Testament and also the which the New Testament is a testimony or commentary to the Old, but there's nothing more important than Leviticus 23 on the Lord's feast days, the Sabbath and his feast days, because in that is all prophecy, past, present, and future. And that's why he wants us to keep those as part of the commandments. Is to keep those high days, your holy days, where most Christians believe or been taught, especially in the generation we're in now, the last generation, the mystery of iniquity is so, it's so much darkness there that the holy days and the feast days, most people don't even have any idea what they are. And if they've heard about them, they say, well, that's the Jewish feast, or the Jews do keep the Sabbath and keep the Passover and trumpets and the feast days. No, they're not the Jews' days or feasts. They're the Lord's feast. He created them. You know, is that, if I say, you know, this is, when people say that, if you understand or if you're following them, you need to correct them. Because it's like he created the moon for this same word in the Greek as Kairos or Moed in Psalms 104:19. He created the moon for to record his seasons. The word seasons there, depending on if you're looking at the Septuagint or the Hebrew. The Hebrew is Moed, the Septuagint Greek word is Kairos. That's the word we're looking at tonight. I follow through the Septuagint and then the use of Polyglot, which is an apostolic translation of the Greek text. Now, so that would be like me, you know, that would be like me saying, well, the moon and the stars and the sun, they were for times and seasons, days and years. That's just for the Jews. You know, we don't get any. That's just a Jewish thing. So God just, he created the moon for the Jews. See? No, he created the moon for those who are his, the moon records his calendar. And of course, how the Lord wants us to know him, he'll be our Elohim, we'll be his people, is he's got instructions for us to follow. So that's where the Torah, the law comes in. And then they were, that was given to Israel, the chosen people, and they were to be a nation of kings and priests that would teach all other nations and mankind about who the Creator is. That's just how the Lord established his orderly arrangement, his cosmos. So as after saying that, you've got to understand how important this is. If you don't understand, you're not following his Sabbath and his holy days, you will be caught as a thief. The day of the Lord will come up on you as a thief in the night. Now, this is what the scripture says. We are in the times of refreshing. That's the same word In the New Testament and the Greek, kairos, the times of refreshing or the redeeming of the Sabbath and the holy days for those that have ears to hear and eyes to see. This has to happen as prophetically before the Lord or before Christ comes from heaven. This was a prophecy that I put up on YouTube. It comes from Acts, the 3rd chapter, verse 19, which Peter prophesied. Peter and John were preaching in Acts there, and Peter prophesied the times of refreshing must come. Now, that word refreshing, people, has to do with a spiritual revival. That's why you see a lot of people now are following the feast days, the Sabbath. You have teachers that are teaching that. You have Hebrew teachers, Israelite teachers, Messianic. So God is, this is the season we're in, times of refreshing have come. So you're going to hear more and more and more about these feast days. Because the prophecy of God's word said it, and we are in this time. Now, we're going to be looking in Psalms 106, and we're going to read some things. Now, there again, you got to understand, it's all in the scripture. It's just been hidden because the mystery of iniquity started creeping in 1900 years ago, Paul said. And of course, in the 3rd century, we had Constantine changed from Saturday worship to Sunday. We had the Saturnalia brought in and as a Christmas festival that's supposed to be worshiping a celebration of Christ, which has nothing to do with that. And then we have the resurrection that was moved from the first fruits of Passover, unleavened bread, and first fruits. We have the resurrection moved to a pagan Easter Sunday, which all comes out of paganism, see. So, you know, and when you first hear that, if you've never heard that, then you're going to say, what do you mean? That's all I've ever worshipped, the resurrection on Sunday morning, and Christ was raised on the first day of the week, and Paul was taking up collections on the first day of the week, and Paul was breaking bread with the disciples on the first day of the week, Acts 20, verse 7. I have those videos up there. None of that in the Greek text is what you've got to go by, people. That's all been translated on the wrong days. And it's been mistranslated, and people have built their whole religion belief and their whole doctrine after those verses. But now the Lord is refreshing the times. The times are refreshing. The truth now is being shown. So when we look at these words, if the Holy Spirit guides you, you're going to see how important, if you are a believer in the Messiah, you must be following him at these times, people. Now, especially where we sit now, because there is so many things happening, and you've got so many prophecy teachers out there. You've got all this, especially with the internet, like on social media, with this to be on YouTube. So you've got all of these things. The rapture is supposed to happen here in a couple of weeks on Feast of Trumpets. I think there's some people calling for that. Some people are calling for all of this destruction. The dollar is going to fall. All of these things are going to happen. The 7-year tribulation is going to start, possibly because of the Semitic years or because of the Jubilee year. We will see. I'm not saying there's not something that's not going to happen, because the love of many is going to wax worse and worse. There's going to be desolations upon desolations unto the consummation of the consummation of the end. But we do know this, the major sign that's coming is 3.5 years and not 7. So this man of sin and the false prophet will stand up for the last 3.5 years. That's the sign to be looking for, people. And that sign will take place on a divine day, which is Passover. I've talked to y'all all about that. And the only way you'll understand that is to follow this word that we're talking about tonight. And this is the word Kairos. Now, let's go to Psalms 106. We'll start in 106, verse 2. Who shall speak the mighty deeds of the Lord? Audibly, who shall offer all his praises? Now, remember, we talk about the prayer in Luke 21:36, the prayer and praises. So who are the ones that are going to speak the deeds of the Lord? Who are the ones that's going to offer all his praises? Okay, look, let's look at 106 verse 3. Now, the word blessed we're looking at tonight, we're looking at blessed, how it lines up with Kairos. The word blessed here, in the Greek, it means fortunate, well-off, blessed, happier, by extension. Okay, now let's see what the Hebrew word blessed is. 835, happiness only in the masculine plural construction as interjection, happy, blessed, happy. Okay, so now go back to the polyglot or the Greek word that's used in the Old Testament here. This also follows the Septuagint. Those that are familiar with the Greek translation Septuagint for the Old Testament. So blessed are the ones keeping, now this word's tero in, or no, it's phileso in the Greek, and it means to preserve, obey, keep, observe, save. See? All right, now, think about this. Blessed are the ones keeping. Equity here has to do with God's divine law, his commandments, people. Well, no, Larry, I thought the commandments have been nailed to the cross. We are saved by grace through faith. Well, that's just part of the equation. You're also, if you love him, if you love the master, he said, you will keep my commandments. You see? All right, so blessed are the ones keeping equity, commandments, and doing, this is peo, means to make or do, righteousness. Of course, when you study the word righteousness, it all has to do with the Torah, his commandments. Okay, notice, doing righteousness in every season, people. Now, right here, very important. Now, let's talk about this just a minute. This is in Psalms 106, verse 3. Notice the Greek words, at all or in every season. The Greek word is en in the Greek, the word all is pos, and the word 2540 is Kairos. I've talked to you about many hours. I never have talked to you about these verses here in the Psalms. That's why I'm bringing this in, and we have the New Testament, which uses the same Greek word that verifies the how it's used in the Psalms. Now just think about this. This is when you're blessed. Now, he did not nail your blessing to the cross, people. You know, he nailed your transgression to the cross, your sin. See, because he made atonement for our sins. Now, if you don't understand what's being said here, then you need to look at some of the prior videos, and especially this video, because if we're not doing this, then we will be caught as a thief, and we are not blessed, and so the opposite of not blessed will be cast into outer darkness or be cursed, see? Now, this is what this means, people. This is very important, and that's why I am blowing the trumpet, and for whoever hears this, because we are watchmen on the wall, and it says to blow the trumpet to those that don't understand, or those on the outside, or the wicked, see? So, and now, then they have heard the trumpet. There's a trumpet in the city that's been blown, and now, depending on what you do with it, is between you and your Creator. But now, you know, it'll be your soul and your blood required on you. But the watchman, see, that's what teachers and watchmen and preachers are supposed to be doing, people. They're not doing it. Everybody's sitting in their own little circle in their denomination thinking they've been saved, worshiping Christ on Sunday and Easter and Christmas. And that's why we're blowing, that's why the times of refreshing have come. We got to repent. We got to come out of that. Start following the Master on his divine days. So right here, blessed are the ones keeping equity and doing righteousness in every season. Now notice the in there again, in all season. Now here is the word, the appointed time. Now, for those that might not have heard any of my videos, what this means is, this is God's, in the Greek is kairos, this is his divine appointments or his holy days. Now in the Hebrew, for you Hebrew people, this, the word kairos here, for you Hebrew teachers, it means the same thing as moed. So once you come to understand that what the Greek text has a word that matches moed, then especially in the renewed covenant, you're going to see things that Christ said that's just going to add to your faith, a hundredfold, because it's in the New Testament. See, you know, most people have not found this word and actually connected it with moed. So this is so very, very important. And so this is how you are blessed. See, if you're keeping his commandments and following his divine days and his Sabbath. Now, the Sabbath is a set-apart day, a divine day. It's a holy day. Passover, unleavened bread, first fruits, Pentecost, we got trumpets coming up, the Day of Atonement coming up, and tabernacles. They're all his divine days that he said right here, you're blessed and do and notice and doing righteousness in every season. Doing, this word is to make or do. In what? Your righteousness is in every divine day and every weekly Sabbath. Remember us, O Lord, with the benevolence of your people. Visit us. Notice now, let's connect the dots here. Very important in verse 4. Remember us. Who is us? The ones that are blessed, that are following Christ on his divine days and his Sabbath. Remember us, O Lord, with the benevolence of your people. Now notice the word visit. In the Old Testament, when it says the Lord will visit us, the Lord can either visit you with a blessing, or he can visit you with a cursing or judgment. So of course this is a blessing. See. So notice here. Now notice what's so very important. Visit us with your deliverance. This is rescue, or to be rescued out of this earth. Now when is that going to happen? That's going to happen on a upcoming fall feast, which is the Day of Atonement. That's when the resurrection of the saints will take place. I'll be talking to you more about that. And there will be more scripture and teaching that I will bring. But see, that is a kairos time, people. That's why you're blessed. If you're redeeming those times and you're following and you're trading the scripture and studying, then you're going to understand the prophecy of the divine appointments. If you think that they've been nailed to the cross and you continue with your Sunday worship, which most people will, according to scripture, many are going to come in that day and say, Lord, Lord, haven't we cast out demons, done many wondrous miracle works, and prophesied in your name, and he's going to say or profess to those people that he never at all knew them. Never. That's in the Greek. That means not never, ever at all had a personal relationship with them people. And you got many people that think they've got a personal relationship with him, but they're not following him and doing his commandments and praising him and worshiping him on his high days or his holidays, you might say, his holy days. This is what the scripture teaches people. Now, notice there again, he's going to visit us with our deliverance. That's when he saves us, people. That's when you are counted worthy in the resurrection. Now, remember these three words right here, if you're found worthy in the resurrection. Remember right here in every season, okay? Now, what I want to do is real quick, I'm going to show you how we connect when we go to the renewed covenant, how I can show you the Messiah is going to tell us something here in Luke 21:36 that fits Psalms 106:3. All right, let me go there and we'll see what we're talking about. Those watching the videos, you should know, but this will give you more scripture because I haven't talked to you about the Old Testament that much where this word is found. So let's look in Luke real quick, 21:36. 21 and verse 36, and we're going to see exactly, remember, I'm showing you the Greek text, the translation, and the Old Testament, and we're going to tie it to the Greek text because the New Testament was translated in Greek. So let's tie them together here. Make them a perfect fit right here. Luke 21:36. Right here. Now, be awake then at every season. Do you see that, people? Notice right here. Right here is the word kairos. Here's in and here's all. The translation from Psalms 106 by the Polyglot or by the Septuagint, and the translation in Luke 21:36 is exactly the same right here, exactly. Season, at every season. It's hard for me to get it highlighted. Well, I'll just have to highlight this part here. But at every season, those three Greek words is the same three Greek words in Psalms 106:3, people. Now, what is the Messiah saying here? He's saying, commanding you, if you're a believer, to pray, watch and pray at every season that you be counted worthy to escape the things that are coming up on the earth and stand before the Son of Man. Now, what does that mean? That means the word worthy has to do in the context of what the Messiah is saying. When you go back to Luke 20:35, you see that those that are found worthy to obtain the age to come and the resurrection from the dead. They don't marry or give in marriage, and they're like the angels, they're deathless. So he's telling us if we're found worthy to be raised from the dead at the last trump or the great trump of God, that's going to be on the Jubilee year of the 10th day of the 7th month, the Day of Atonement, when that horn sounds, that trumpet sounds in that season, then the dead in Christ arise and those alive remain will be changed in a moment, twinkling of an eye, and be called up to meet the Lord and in the air ever at all times and will be with the Lord. Now, do you connect what Psalms is saying and what Christ is saying, people? Now, the psalmist writer is telling you're blessed if you're keeping his commandments and you are following him on the divine days. Christ is telling you here, for you to be found worthy in the resurrection, you got to be doing the same thing, people. And not only doing it, he says, petition me. Why? Why have we got to petition Christ that we be found worthy and pray that prayer on the Sabbath and the divine days? Why have we got to do that? Because he's our heavenly high priest now. The Torah was changed. The Levitical priesthood was changed. Christ now, being the heavenly high priest, and also the Levitical line was done away with, and all of the sacrificing of the goats and the animals was done away with. Now, what people don't realize, when Paul says that the law was a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ, see, that's true. But see, when we come to Christ, he didn't do away with his commandments or his holy days. See, we're not under the law. We've been forgiven now because we've repented of our sins. But he now is who we follow. He is now our mediator. He is now who we're being conformed to. But not, he didn't do away with his commandments. But when we come to Christ, understand, the law, under the law, was a schoolmaster. The bull and goats and sacrifices of the animal never was intended. It was a schoolmaster. It never was intended to forgive, be atoned for their sins. Never. It was just set in place until the Messiah got here. So the Levitical line, see, so those part of the Torah of the law changed, but not doing away with his commandments or shadows of good things to come, which is his holy days, people. Why do you think the Bible says in Zechariah 4:16, three times, all nations it's left over that Christ is not destroyed at the Battle of Armageddon at the very end of this age are going to come up to Jerusalem to worship the King? Because the prophecy out of Acts 2:30 is that Christ will sit on his father's king throne, which is King David's throne, and he will rule the earth from Jerusalem. So all nations left over are going to come up year to year. What time is that? That's Tishri, the seventh month, 15th day of the seventh month. All nations that's left over will come up year to year and worship the King and keep the Feast of Sukkot, Tabernacles, a seven-day celebration with the eighth day on the end, which is a high day there, a solemn day. So that's future to us. So for you people that think that he's done away with this, what do you think people, the nations, and those that are in the body of Christ are going to be involved with during the millennium, people? You got to wake up and come out of your sleep. Okay, now notice here. So right here, be awake then in every season, beseeching, praying that you be deemed worthy. Right here, you're deemed worthy to flee all the things that are about to take place and stand before the Son of Man when you're called up to meet him in the air. And so what, now see, what you're going to escape, this is, I've said before over and over, is a big rapture verse. This is what the rapturists use. But see, that the people that teach the rapture, people, you got to understand, you got to wake up now. For those that have eyes to see and ears to hear, this is so important. The biggest part of people that preachers that preach the rapture, and there's hundreds of millions of so-called Christians that believe in the rapture. Just go on the internet and look about the rapture. But see, they do not know what this verse actually means, people. I'm breaking it down, dividing it for you. Christ is not talking about there's no rapture in the scripture, people. This is after the tribulation. This has to do with the resurrection of the dead. Now, you're going to be raised from the dead, 1 Thessalonians 4:16. If you're found worthy in the resurrection. Well, if you can read what we've just been studying, this short Bible study here, according to Psalms, you're blessed if you are keeping His divine days and His Sabbath. According to Christ, you got to be praying on those days. You got to ask the Lord and pray at all times in every season. So your prayer to Him has to be prayed on those days. Now do you see, you're blessed if you're doing, and if you're doing that, then the promise is that you will be counted worthy in the resurrection to escape the things that are coming up on earth. Now let's talk real briefly about escaping things that will be coming up on the earth. Now the rapture people that use this verse as a 3.5 year rapture in the middle of the tribulation or at the front end of the 7 year tribulation, it's to escape the tribulation. Well, there's a thing about we are appointed to the tribulation people, so they're wrong in that aspect, but we are not appointed to God's wrath. Well, see, God's wrath is what we're going to escape, because when Christ comes back, He is going to destroy many nations at the Battle of Armageddon, people. The Bible speaks that so many bodies are going to be slain, there's no place to bury them. There's not enough people to bury the bodies. See? Now, the point I'm saying is, that's God's wrath. Now, God's wrath was poured out on Jerusalem in 70 AD. People forget about that. But if you go and look at and read Josephus, what he said happened in those 3.5 years when the Roman army surrounded Jerusalem, it was unbelievable, the decimation or the destruction of Jerusalem. Not just the temple wall, people, or the temple, but how so many Judeans were slaughtered and died. See, it's the same thing is coming. So that's what you're going to escape. Plus, you're going to share in the inheritance, and blessed are you that have part in the first resurrection. For guess what? The lake of fire has no authority over us. Has no authority over us. But if you're not found in the first resurrection worthy to be raised from the dead, then the resurrection for you comes after the millennium at the white throne judgment, when your works come before God and His book is open, and this book right here that we're studying and writing divine is the book that's going to judge His whole creation, people. That book is the one, everybody will be adjudged according to this book. See? So this is paramount, very important that you, if whoever's listening to this, go look at these verses. Get into the scripture. Prove, don't take my word, prove what I'm saying. I want you to, people, because I'm not going to give you anything, Lord willing, that is going to cause you to stray away. We've all been raised on Easter, Christmas, and all of this pagan stuff, people. That's why you got to come out of Mystery Babylon. If you have ears to hear, and start following Messiah on His divine days, people. Now, right here, so we see what Christ is saying, and this has to do with your resurrection. Now, one more place, and then we're going back to Psalms. Let's go to Ephesians. I've talked about this before. Let's go to Ephesians 6. And we're going to look at Ephesians 6:18. I've put several tape of videos up on this if you haven't had a chance to watch them. Right here. Now, this is the same thing right here. Through all prayer. Now, Paul is telling us this. Christ told us. Now, Paul is going to tell us the same thing that Christ said. Uh-oh. Didn't mean to do that, so let me go back up here. right here, Ephesians 6:18. Let me stop right. Okay. Now, let me bring it down so you can see. Okay. Through all prayer and supplication, praying at every time, see, at every season. Here is the same three words, people, at poskros. Here it is. Paul's using the same three that Christ commanded us to pray about the resurrection. At every time, in the Spirit and in the same thing, being awake, being sleepless, with all attention and supplication for all the holy ones. Now see, what is all our prayers and supplications about? We are to petition God at these times through our Master Yahshua, because no man comes to the Father except through the Son. So all our prayers in His divine times and on His Sabbath that we're praying for the body of Christ or for all those who are like-minded, and also for the 12 tribes that's already been resurrected as first fruits or Rashid, the first rank in order, that are in heaven waiting for the same Moed. As they descend from heaven, we are raised from the dead, or those alive remain. We're going to meet them in the air to go back into the land, because in the 50th Jubilee, all land goes back to its rightful owner. Because all things written in the Torah, the prophets, and the Psalms, the five talents, the two, and the one, Christ must fulfill concerning Him. Well, He is King of Israel. He has His bride, the redeemed of Jacob. He now, at the appropriate season, He's got to resurrect the body of Christ, the children of the kingdom, the kings and priests, and those that have been invited. Blessed are those, same word, blessed are those that have been invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb, people. And so that time will happen on the same Moed. They will descend from heaven and we will ascend, being in the resurrection. So the resurrection and the rapture, people talk about the rapture, the resurrection is the rapture. See, but it's not 3.5 years before or 7 years before, people. That is incorrect. All those people that teach that, 99.9% of them don't even know. They're not in covenant with the Messiah. They worship on common profane days. They keep Christmas and Easter, and they think they're the church and they're separated from Israel. And the renewed covenant is with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. That's the new covenant. It's not with all these denominations. It's not in the scripture. So I just hope that whoever's listening to this video, that it will cause you, even if it frustrates you, or even if you want to stone me or cut me off, but before you do, go check out what I'm saying. Now let's go back to Psalms here. Okay, let's go back to Psalms. Okay, right here we were in Psalms 103, and this has to do with the ones that's doing righteousness in every season. See, right? I mean, if you just say, what's righteousness? Well, if you're praying, keeping His commandments, following His Sabbath, following His divine days, and then the scripture tells you what to do, that's righteousness, people. So what would unrighteousness be? This is not hard. It would be worshiping Him like most people do. That's on Satan's calendar. This is not God's calendar. Okay, now I want to look at 2 Chronicles 9:7. Okay, here's this word blessed. We're looking at the word blessed. Blessed are your men, blessed are your servants, these, the ones standing beside you always and hearing your wisdom. Okay? Now, understanding, see, you're going to see The Psalm says you're blessed if you're following His divine times and His holy days. So notice, blessed are your men, blessed are your servants, these, the ones standing beside you, always in hearing your wisdom. Now, okay, let's talk about this scripture here. This is prophecy too. So notice when the writer says, standing beside you always and hearing, that means to hear and obey, but they hear and obey your wisdom. So when do we hear and obey His wisdom? At all times, people. That's when you're blessed. So that's when you're going, that's when the Holy Spirit is going to reveal to you His wisdom during these Sabbath days, weekly Sabbath days, and high days and holy days. That's exactly what the writer is saying here, people. That this is when you will hear of God's wisdom, see? Right here in the scripture is what it's talking about. Okay, now let's look at another verse here. Let's look at, we'll see in Job 5:17. And blessed is the man who the Lord reproves, right here, and does not refuse admonition of the Almighty. That's what the text is saying. So you are blessed if you take God's instruction, if you take His correction. See, and when He admonishes you or corrects you, and you obey that admonishment or correction instead of becoming stiff-necked and arrogant heart, then you are a blessed man or a soul that does that. Because we got to bow, we got to submit before Him. He is the one that has chosen us. He is the one that we're being created in Christ. To be fitted up in advance there, and He is the one that has to correct us His word. See, we have to come as Him as a little child, be trained up in correction and chastisement. And notice what it says again, and the man that is blessed, the Lord reproves and does not refuse His admonition. Look what the word reprove means. Reprove means admonishment, convict, convince, tell, rebuke, or reprove. See, and admonishment there means to put in mind, that is to caution or reprove with a gently admonishment or a warning. See, of the Almighty, and you do not refuse that correction or that warning. Okay, let's continue here. Now I want to look at Psalms 1. Psalms 1:1. Blessed is a man who went not in the counsel of the impious ones, and in the way of sinners stood not there. And then it says, set not upon a chair of the mischievous ones. So you're blessed now. Now, there again, when you follow this, he's telling you what not to do, see. You're blessed if you do not sit in the council of man's doctrine, people. That's what he's talking about. The Pharisees, what did he warn the apostles? Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. And they thought he was talking about bread. And he said, no, I'm talking about the leaven, the doctrines, the oral law and doctrines of the Pharisees. Well, that's why he's saying you're blessed when you do not sit in among that doctrine, see. Now, you got to understand the very first correction that he gives to us about what not to do, or what a warning about the signs after the temple and after the sign of the Son of Man, the very next thing he said, take heed unto you so that you be not deceived, that many are going to come in my authority in my name and deceive many people. Now see, there's only one name under heaven that we got to be saved, and that's his name. But isn't it amazing he is telling you that his name, there's going to be many preached in his name that are not going to be saved, but are going to be deceived. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing revelation that his name is the only name? But he's also telling you his name is going to lead by the false teachers are going to lead many to the lake of fire. They're going to lead many to deception and error. And that's where you fall in to many are going to come in that day. And see, he does not know them people, and they're all preaching in his name, prophesying his name, doing great miracles and wonders in his name, and casting out devils. And he, that was one of the first warnings he gave to us. Okay, now, that's Matthew 24, verse 4 and 5. Okay, so we see here, very important in Psalms 1, 1. Now let's look in there, let's look in Psalms 2, 12. Okay, grab instruction. This is an imperative, but this is a command. Grab instruction, at least at any time, you should provoke the Lord to anger, and you shall perish from the hodos, the just way, his way. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Here is the Greek word hodos. Notice, you shall perish, this right here means to lose, destroy, perish, die, right here, from the just way, whenever his rage should be kindled quickly. Notice, and it says, blessed are all the ones yielding upon him. That means, the word yielding means, it means authority, agree, assure, or believe upon him. So, now, notice people, what is this word grab instruction, or it means to take a hold of his instruction. See, the word instruction here is doctrine, right here. It also means education, training, discipline, correction, chastening, chastening. It has to do with a little child being grabbing a hold of his instruction. See. So very important. His instruction is his doctrine, and we take over, we come to him as a little child, so we can be trained up. All right, let's see if we can find right here, Psalms 33:12. Blessed is the nation of which the Lord is its God, and a people whom he chose for his own inheritance, people. See, this is what we have, this is our, we are Christ's inheritance with the Father's inheritance and the 12 tribes. This will be part of our lot, part of our inheritance. Now, let's look in, I'm not going to hit every one of these. You need to go look them up and do a word study. Let's look at Psalms 40, verse 4. Blessed is the man of which is in the name, the authority of the Lord, his hope, and did not look to the follies and the frenzies, or the false frenzies, see. Now, what does false mean? False means erroneous, deceitful, wicked, false, liar, untrue. Now, I've got just a little bit of time left. I want to go to something and show you how Paul uses this word false. But before we do that, blessed is the man of which is in the name or the authority of of the Lord, his hope. Now the word hope here, 1680, it means this is not wishing, this is actually expectation, anticipation, confidence, faith, hope. Now, what I want to do is I'm going to go to a place right here and tie this in with what Paul was saying in Acts the 26th chapter. I think you'll find this very, very enlightening. Well, let me get back. I got to go to Acts 26. Acts chapter 26. And we're going to look in. I'll just flip over here in the King James. There's many people that's used to the King James. Okay. All right. Okay, right here, Paul is coming before King Agrippa, and he's coming before him and giving a testimony. You know, so, and he has plenty of other witnesses, Agrippa, there, and that's listening to his this testimony. And we see in verse Acts 26:6. And now I stand and am judged for the hope, people. Right here is the same word that was used that I just showed you in Psalms 41. Right here, the word hope means confidence, faith, expectation, anticipation. But Paul is telling King Gripper, I'm judged for the hope of the promise made of Elohim unto our fathers. Now, let's talk about this. Who is our fathers here, people? What is Paul referring to here? Is he talking about, you think he's talking about your daddy or my daddy? No, he's talking about our spiritual fathers, the covenant that God made with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So what promise was that? The promise was that all the land that was given to Abraham, and that Abraham would become the father of many nations, and out of Abraham, the seed of Isaac, which would be the promised seed, which is Christ, and then all those that believe on him, of course, that are going to have part of the kingdom and are going to teach the nations in the millennium, this is part of Abraham's. This is Abraham, all nations will be blessed because there is some in all nations, all flesh. That's why the gospel goes to all nations. And then you will have some then that will turn to follow the Messiah, and that seed or the new birth or the being born again of the Spirit, the seed of Christ comes in us, which is his word. That's what when we do. We trade his word. We warn people. We witness his word. We teach people his word. So this is what this is about. But notice the hope here, and then Paul's going to go a little bit further, which not many people understand. I want to show you something here. The hope of the promise made of God unto the fathers. Well, see, the promise, people, under the old covenant, or under Abraham's covenant, was that all land would go through Isaac as an inheritance. And then it would go to Jacob, and then the 12 tribes. See, now that land that they're all fighting over there and trying to get a two-state solution, Palestine, most of the Arabs are already in the biggest part of Abraham's land. So what little bit they have there in the West Bank or in Jerusalem or thereabouts, the Tel Aviv in there, is a very small portion of the land that was given to Abraham. So a lot of people don't, they think they're trying to take that land there in Jerusalem. That's all prophecy. But when Christ comes to set up his kingdom and comes back with his bride and his subjects or the body of Christ there, they're going to be given all the land, the title deed of the land, because it's God's land, see? There again, it's the Lord's feast. Well, that's the land that was given to Abraham and them. The covenant now has not fully been fulfilled because we're not back in the land, and Christ is not sitting on David's throne ruling the planet yet. Okay, so that's prophecy that has to happen. So Paul back then, he's standing and judged for the hope of the promise. Now notice what he says in the next verse, people, which most people have no idea what this means. But hopefully if you'll follow some of these videos, it's being revealed unto which, and this has to do in the context of which promise. So the promise in the context is our 12 tribes instantly serving Elohim day and night. And here's this word hope again. And there's hope to come. For which hope, here's this word hope, that Paul is trusting in. Because he knows what the covenant is. He knows that the 12 tribes were resurrected after Christ's resurrection. When the graves broke open, the many saints that slept come out of their graves after his resurrection. So he's telling the king all of this. Excuse me, I'm getting a little bit hoarse. Okay, so this is going to be part of his testimony to King Agrippa. And he's saying, I am being accused of the Jews of trying to kill Paul for Paul's preaching and this testimony. Now notice in verse 6-8, why should it be thought a thing incredible with you that God should raise the dead, people? This right here. Okay, very important, so very, very important, people. Try to get a hold of this. See, the times are refreshing to come because we're going to be revealed exactly what the apostles preached and taught and believed in as far as the gospel of the kingdom of heaven, and that's what they died for. Now, why would Paul talk about the 12 tribes and say they're in heaven? Well, now Rachel's children is in the reference in Matthew 2 was fulfilled when King Herod slayed the two-year-old males trying to get to Jesus Christ, and so Herod put out a decree to kill all two-year-old males and under, which is called Rachel weeping for her children, which comes from Jeremiah 31:15. It has to come from a prophet. Also comes from Isaiah 26:19. Also comes from the Torah, Leviticus. It comes from Psalms, people. It's all in the scripture and it's all in the New Testament, see. Now, you might say, well, Larry, what are you getting to? Well, what I'm getting to is the same thing Paul is getting to. I am witnessing to whoever's watching this video that my testimony is the same, and all believers should be the same as Paul's, because Paul is part of the renewed covenant and a master teacher, and we were once a Gentile, now we've been grafted in to the commonwealth of the house of Israel. Paul tells you that in Ephesians 2:12 and 2:13. Now notice this right here. Let me show you something, people. Right here, we're going to have to close here in a minute, but let me show you something when you study and what you find out when you study. You see the 12 tribes is used with one Greek number. The only time in the renewed covenant that Paul uses one Greek word to combine both 12 and tribes. He uses one Greek word. Now the rest of the time, you're going to find 12 tribes used several times in the New Testament, but it's always used with 12 in the Greek and tribes in the Greek. But this time, Paul combines them into one Greek word. And then we get the definition out of that one Greek word, and notice what it is. Unbelievable. Look what it is right here. Right here. The 12 tribes is Dedekaphalun. Dedekaphalun. And I'm sure I'm pronouncing that wrong. But it comes from 12, and it comes from 12 tribes put together. It means the Commonwealth of Israel, 12 tribes. Now, this is so unbelievable, people, because when you go to Ephesians, the second chapter, around verse 12, Paul tells you that by believing in the Messiah, and you've been grafted back into the natural olive tree, that now you're not aliens, but now you are citizens with the commonwealth of the house of Israel, people. So, see, my testimony is the same as Paul's. Everybody's that understands who they are in Christ, this is part of the gospel. See, the gospel is our 12 tribes were resurrected on first fruits, as first fruits to Elohim and the Lamb, Revelation 14:4, when the graves broke open, when the Messiah gave up the Ruach in Matthew 27:50, 51, 52, and 53. That's my testimony. I cannot preach the resurrection of Jesus Christ and without preaching the resurrection of the 12 tribes, and none of the apostles could either, or we would be found a false witness. Now, remember when I showed you over in Psalms that you're blessed when you are taking your correction and you're following, and that way you will not be found a false witness or a false teacher? Well, notice right here, Paul is going to come, and he's saying that the 12 tribes are serving God night and day. Well, now, how in the world did the 12 tribes, Rachel's children, how did they get there? They were resurrected after Christ's resurrection as first fruits, people. Matthew 27:52. So Christ took them to heaven. Now you're going to have people say, well, no, there's no man ascended to heaven except Jesus Christ. That is correct. That's 1 Timothy 6:16. Already know all these verses. So all you people out there that think you're fixing to ambush me on something, well, you're going to have to get up awful early, and if I boast, I'm not boasting myself, I'm boasting in the Lord, because I have studied his scripture. Now, Paul would not be talking about this if it wasn't scripturally sound, but what you got to understand, these were not men, these were two-year-old males and under. They were the holy innocent, the slaughter of the holy innocent. They had not come to the accountability of sin, people. So therefore, Christ is the only man that has ascended. But this is his bride, the 12 tribes, that he also raised from the dead. Now, Paul is going to tell us, the next thing Paul's going to say here to King Agrippa. Now, why would Paul say this? And this is in context with the 12 tribes. Why should it be thought a thing so incredible to you that God should raise the dead? He's already raised the dead. Now, the dead here, people, is not talking about Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ is in the singular masculine in the Greek. Well, Larry, what does that mean? Well, these dead right here is in the plural masculine. Paul is not even speaking of Jesus Christ's resurrection here. He's talking about the 12 tribes' resurrection. Now see, this is going to hit, but see, these people do not understand this. Now before I close, I've got to tie one more thread as we've come with why we have to be on his calendar and worshiping and following him so we can obtain this wisdom and understanding, because this all comes out of the Torah, the prophets, and the Psalms, and now we have the renewed covenant that confirms that testimony, because it's full of the same testimony, people. All right, now, right here, so let's go to 1 Corinthians Let's go to 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter. And this is Paul talking. Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel. Now here's the gospel, people, which I preached unto you, which also you have received, wherein you histomai, you stand straight on this gospel. You do not get off of this teaching, Paul says, the gospel which he has taught to them, by which also you are saved. Notice, through the teaching here, through this gospel, you're saved. If you keep in memory what I preached unto, unless you have believed in vain, and of course you will see destruction then. So Paul is telling you, you've got to believe and follow the gospel, unless you just think, if you just believe it's okay, but you, there is believing. That means, that's a verb, that shows action. Okay, now, 15:3, for I delivered unto you first how all that which I also received, how Christ died for our sins. How did he die for our sins, people? According to the scriptures. Now, if you leave this out right here, if you don't understand what Paul's saying right there, scriptures, then you haven't, you don't know what the gospel is. Because the scriptures is the front of the book. This is not the renewed covenant, people. In other words, the testimony has to come from the front. Christ died on the 14th day of Nisan for your sins and mine, according to the Torah. According to them rehearsing the killing of the lamb on the 14th day of Nisan, he fulfilled that. He went in his tomb on unleavened bread because he was the bread from heaven without sin. Now, when he was raised from the dead, right here, and that he was buried, he had to be put in the tomb before sundown or before dark, or all the land in Israel would be hearsed according to Torah. He had to be taken off the cross and put in the tomb, people. If he'd have been left hanging up on the cross during the dark there, after it got dark, then according to Torah, this is the destruction of Torah. If you don't know that, you're not understanding what he had to fulfill, his word, his scripture, the front of the book. Now we've been told that's all been nailed to the cross, people. So that's where you're being deceived. You got to get back on his divine days. You got to study the front of the book. And you got to be a witness to this gospel. Notice, according to that he was buried and that rose again the third day. Notice, people, the third day according to the scriptures. What scriptures, Larry? The Torah, the prophets, and the Psalms. That's why I trade them with y'all so much on the internet, or if you're here at my assembly. We trade these scriptures because he said, will I find the faithful trading my scriptures? And that's how you're going to be rewarded, people. All right, now, notice, so this is what, this is so pertinent and important that you understand this. Now, when you, then he goes through an order here. So let's go on through his order. Paul being the last one to come to the apostle there. And so now we start here in verse 11. Wherefore, whether I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. What did they preach in the gospel? Whether I preach, Paul's saying, or whether the apostles or any of those that were following the Messiah. So Paul's saying, whether I or the rest of the apostles, they were all preaching the same thing. Now, notice right here, people, in 15:12. Now, if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you there is no resurrection of the dead? Well, people, read right over this. Christ is in the singular. He rose is singular. But when he says, how does some among you, there is no resurrection of the dead, he's not talking about Jesus here. He's talking about Rachel's children. This is plural masculine. He's talking about right here, people, he's talking about what Matthew said, Matthew 27:52. That's what Paul's talking about. When Christ gave up the Ruach, what happened? There was an earthquake. The temple was rent from top to bottom. The rocks are rent and the graves are open. And many saints that slept come out of their tombs after his resurrection. So Paul is saying, if you don't preach the resurrection of the many saints that come out of their tomb, then you can't preach the Christ resurrection. Because the Bible tells you that when Christ died, the graves were opened. Ezekiel tells you this. There's the dry bones are put back together. I've got also a video about, that's a whole witness about the dry bones is all the house of Israel. It even tells you that the graves are open. It even tells you an earthquake opened them, people. And now we have that witness through Matthew. So Paul is just telling Matthew's witness to the graves opening. Paul is saying right here, why are you not preaching the resurrection of Matthew 27:51, 52, 53? Of the dead, plural masculine. It's not about Jesus' resurrection. This is he rose from the dead. This is singular. But how, say some among you, there is no resurrection of the dead? He's not talking about his resurrection. He's talking about the plural masculine, the graves that were open. Now look what Paul says in 13. If there be no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen, people. Now what do you think? Now most preachers, when they preach this, they read right over it. It don't make any difference if they're doctors or whatever they are. They are not following God. If they were following God on his divine appointments, they would know what this is. If they study this, they'll see what's being said here. See? But see, why would Paul say, if there's no resurrection of the dead, plural masculine, then Christ is not risen? See? He's not talking about a future resurrection, people. He's not talking about our resurrection. It ain't happened yet. See? He's talking about the resurrection of the graves that open and come out of their tombs after his resurrection. So you can't speak of just Christ was raised. What are you going to do with the 144,000 raised? What are you going to do? What are you going to tell Paul when Paul was confessing to King Agrippa? Hey, our 12 tribes are already in heaven. Why so unbelievable that God's already raised them from the dead? Why are you having such a great problem with that? See? And when you come to understand this, then you're going to understand that where your identity is. Why would Paul call them, he said, our 12 tribes? If you have eyes, see, and ears to hear, and you're following Messiah, your prayer needs to go up on those divine days, not only for our assemblies or those that are worldwide being assembled at this time on the divine days, but our 12 tribes, for our hope, like Paul's hope. Our hope is that they come back at the 50th Jubilee, which we are in expectation and trust in God, because that's the promise he made with our fathers. See, and because you are now part of the household of the Commonwealth of Israel. Unbelievable, people. Now, right here, I'm going to touch on one more scripture for you. Right here in verse 15. Now, remember a few minutes ago I talked to you about when you are following Christ, when it says you're blessed. And when you are come to do and follow him on his divine appointments, his kairos times. And then we went over all these verses about being blessed and that you will hear his wisdom through his word on these times. Now, what I was going to do, now notice that word when I read to you about spurious teacher or false. Remember that word? Well, let's see where Paul uses it right here. yea, and we are found false, here's this word right here, a spurious witness of an untrue testimony. See, this was one of the words that I talked to you back in Psalms there, that that you do not want to be found this, in other words. Paul is saying we will be found a false witness of God because we have testified, they were there, they witnessed that God, he raised up Christ. This is singular masculine. All right, but Paul is saying, whom he raised not up, if so, that the dead rise not. Now, this is not talking about me and you people. This is talking about 2,000 years ago, or close to it, when Christ resurrected the first fruits after his resurrection. See, this is the dead. This is plural masculine. It's not talking about us. But look what Paul says. In other words, what is he saying here? Let's go to the Greek text and let's read what the polyglot. And we are found even as false witnesses of God, for we witness concerning God that he raised the Christ. Now, notice, that's what we, this is true. But notice what the text is saying. But whom he raised not, he didn't raise him, if, right here, if indeed, this means perhaps if so be that sin through, it is so, what does that mean? That means drawing a conclusion, it means a decisive inference, it means no doubt, it means therefore truly, see? So if so, the dead are not raised. This is talking about the saints that slept, that their graves broke open. This is what this is talking about, people. There it is, this word right here, hurrah. It means drawing a particle denoting decisive as follows. What manner? No doubt. So that's what Paul is the emphasis on right here. All right, let's read again. We are found and as false witness, if I don't preach the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the first fruits, which is Rachel's children, which is the 144,000, if I don't give you that testimony that you're getting right now, or if I don't witness that to somebody, this is part of the gospel of the kingdom, then I will be found a false witness, which means a spurious witness that is a bearer of an untrue testimony, false witness. Now, people, as I close, I just want to ask anybody out there, if I'm a bearer of an untrue, false testimony, when the resurrection comes, do you think the Messiah, me, I've been out here being a false witness to his kingdom that will offend his kingdom? Do you think that he's going to put white linen on me and I'm going to enter the kingdom and sit down with my father, spiritual father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob at the table there in the kingdom? Do you think that that's going to happen? Or do you think I'm going to lose my inheritance? Because, see, there's no false witness of the kingdom people that's going to enter the kingdom. See, now, this is what the scripture is saying. Now, maybe you're a listener and not a teacher that's hearing this, and most people are. Well, if you're a listener and you've got a preacher, that you're pretty close to, or you got a rabbi that you're pretty close to, or a bishop, or wherever you're going to your assembly, whether it be on the holy days or the profane days, if you've heard this message and God has pricked your heart, play this over, write these scriptures down, and by all means, go to whoever's teaching you, or your preacher, evangelist, or whoever, and show them these scriptures, people, because the times of refreshing have come. We have got to repent because the Lord is coming. See? And you do not want to be caught as a thief in the night. And so you've got to get on his calendar. But for those that are listening and you come to understand what I'm saying, do not bury this, people. Do not bury this treasure. Because if you be ashamed of God's words, he said, I will be ashamed of you before the Father. And may the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, may that spirit witness to your spirit as we have traded these scriptures with one another. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and soon coming King. Amen.